السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him upon all conditions. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. And may he bless every single one of us. And may he grant us goodness in this world and the next. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our offspring in a way that they too serve the deen in an upright manner, such that they also contribute towards this beautiful deen and earn Jannah by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we have just completed the month of Ramadan. And the hadith speaks of a dua of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam was climbing on the minbar, and one of the du'as was وَيْلٌ لِّمَنْ أَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانَ فَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. Woe be, or destruction be upon the one who has witnessed the month of Ramadan and did not achieve forgiveness. This means Ramadan is the month of forgiveness, where forgiveness is being distributed and literally in our language dished out completely. Foolish is a person who does not get from that forgiveness. If you were desperately in need of something and you heard that it is being distributed wholesale just outside, it is only arrogance and pride that would make you not want to go and get from it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So when a person is searching for forgiveness, desperately in need of that forgiveness, and Allah says, I'm dishing it out completely, then it would only be the pride and the arrogance within a person that would not want them to achieve that forgiveness. However, there are many other deeds that need to be taken into consideration, because they too would result in a person's entry into Jannah. Ultimately, that is what I want, and that is what we all want. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah. So I want to spend a few moments looking at these deeds, the deeds of Jannah, the deeds that would result in a person entering Jannah. We spoke about fasting, and we spoke about how one can achieve forgiveness in Ramadan. At the same time, although it may be important for me to start with Iman, but let me start with the issue of fasting. Because indeed, not only the month of Ramadan should we be fasting in, but rather even in Shawwal, you and I know there are 6 fasts that are a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and highly recommended. He says, "Man sama Ramadan thumma atba'ahu sittan min Shawwal kana ka siyam ad-dahr." And I'm sure by now we know what that means. So above that, 2 days a week, every Monday and Thursday, it's a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Try that. Try it out sometimes. It's not farad, it's not compulsory, but it's a sunnah. Also, we have the fasting 3 days in the lunar calendar, the lunar month. So the 13th, 14th and 15th, try it sometimes. You will find the benefits of it, not only spiritual and religious, but even the health benefits of it are tremendous. On top of that, there is a special door through which those people who are serious about fasting in this world will enter from when it comes to Jannah. So those who were fasting and those who used to take it seriously, did it for the sake of Allah, for the right reasons, they will be granted entry into Jannah through a door known as Ar-Rayyan. Why we say those who took it seriously? Some people fast to lose weight. Some people, sadly, gain weight in the month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us guidance. Some people fast in order for it to be solely and only beneficial to their health. If that is the case, perhaps you might achieve some of that. But what will happen regarding your link with Allah? The answer is, well, you've spoilt it because your intention was wrong. However, if your intention is correct, and on top of that, you do see the health benefits, etc., that was a bonus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. So let's take fasting more seriously, my brothers and sisters, outside the month of Ramadan. I call on yourselves and myself to become a little bit more serious about the 6 fasts of Shawwal. They do not have to be consecutive. They can be any days of the month of Shawwal besides the first one. And at the same time, if you have qada or you have missed fasts of Ramadan, do them first, because those are obligatory. and the rest become sunnah. And we cannot give preference to the sunnah over that which is farad, although they are both very important. So my brothers and sisters, that is one thing. Also, let's become more serious about the two fasts every week. Try it out sometime, like we say. Also, the fasts of the month, the three fasts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. We have several other fasts in the year, but if we start with these, then inshallah, we will be introduced to those. Similarly, going to Jannah, you require Iman, but together with Iman, something else. Your Iman alone will not take you to Jannah. Remember that. Nowhere in the Quran does Allah say the mu'minun will get Jannah. He always says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ. If you want a guaranteed place in Jannah, you need to believe, and on top of your belief, you need to work towards it. You need to do good deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say those who believe will attain Jannah, because He knows there will be people who say, I believe, we believe, we believe. But in essence, they don't believe, because evidence of belief is in your deeds. You can say what you want. Allah says, قَالَتِ الْأَعْرَابُ آمَنَّا قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا أَسْلَمْنَا وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. The Bedouins at the time, they said, we are believers. Allah says, tell them you are not believers. You've only surrendered. But Iman has not yet entered your heart. You might be doing deeds outwardly, but only Allah knows the condition of your heart. So your condition needs to be correct in terms of the insides in your heart. And on top of that, your deeds need to prove that you believe. You say with your tongue, and you work towards it also with your body parts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So Iman, it's extremely important for us to realize that together with Iman, you also need good deeds. One might say, well, I have Iman, but I'm weak. I'm weak in the sense that I've committed certain sins here and there. Well, I want to inform you, another way of earning paradise is to keep seeking the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You ask Allah's forgiveness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you Jannah. At-ta'ibu min al-dhanbi kaman la dhanba lah. I'm sure we've heard this a few times, the meaning of which is the one who has repented from sin is equivalent to he who has no sin at all. So if you want to wipe out your past, there is a way in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that way is to seek forgiveness. But you have one problem. What is the problem? When you have wronged a fellow human being, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go and sort your mess out with that fellow human being first, and then I will forgive you the rest of it. But I will not take the right of a fellow human being of yours away when you have wronged him. He has the right to say, oh Allah, I want justice here. And the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate court, where Allah says, La ظلم اليوم. On this day there will be no oppression. The truth is manifest, it is clear. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about sorting out the problems between yourselves before it is too late. If you sort it out in this dunya, perhaps you will achieve the mercy of Allah. If people have the arrogance to say, I leave this for the day of Qiyamah, they have no clue. Perhaps it will turn out that they would have been wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Sometimes we are convinced that we are right, but in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are totally wrong. It would be absurd to leave that to the day of judgment, and suddenly you find out on that day, oh no, what did I do? No matter what, we'd rather have sorted it out. It's one of the ways of earning Jannah. Allah says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ. It's a long verse, but the beginning of it is, race towards, make haste towards the forgiveness of Allah and paradise. These two things. What does that mean? Anything that will result in me getting to Jannah, I need to rush towards it. I must not worry about anything. I must run towards achieving Jannah. I must run towards achieving the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ultimately, if you have lost the entire dunya, your whole life was a mess. But if it was in the right side, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the page, then you have achieved Jannah. You will achieve the mercy of Allah. You lost nothing. People will forget about the difficulties they had for the 60 or 70 years that they were on this earth. once we achieve the goodness of Jannah, we forget of the problems of the dunya. And once we achieve the evil of Jahannam, may Allah protect us, we forget about the luxuries of this dunya that we had. So my brothers and sisters, the luxuries we have are all temporary. They are very, very temporary. Like we say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. We will make use of what the dunya has offered us on condition that we do not give it preference over the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the law and the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. Similarly, what is of utmost importance for us to note is one of the ways of achieving Jannah and paradise is to develop your consciousness of Allah. It is known as taqwa. Take a look at a beautiful hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he was asked by the companions, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what are the deeds that if I were to do them, I would achieve paradise? Or what are the deeds that the people who entered paradise have engaged in? What are their qualities? They entered Jannah. What are their qualities? He made mention of two things, just two things. What are they? He says, تَقْوَى اللَّهِ وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقِ. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and sisters, he says, the consciousness of Allah and great character and conduct. Those are the two things that will take you to paradise. Think very carefully of what I've just said. Great character and conduct can actually make you get a rank of a friend of Allah, according to one of the narrations. The Prophet ﷺ says a person can achieve the high ranks in the eyes of Allah through good character and conduct. And also a narration makes mention of how when a person's character and conduct is not good, it is a sign of their loose connection with Allah. They don't have a strong connection with Allah. They don't respect the other creatures whom the same Allah has created. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So a sign of your piety is your character, your conduct. Exemplary, absolutely beautiful. You work hard on developing it. The same narration says, O Messenger, tell us about the people of the fire. What are the characteristics of theirs? He says two things would land them in Jahannam: al-famu wal-farju. Astaghfirullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. He says two things: the tongue and the private parts. And this is why in another narration he says to his companions, any one of you who guarantees me the correct use of that which lies between the cheeks, meaning the tongue, and that which lies between the thighs, meaning the private parts, I guarantee him a place in Jannah. Think of it carefully. It means it has to be a serious matter. Immorality is something that can lead you to Jahannam. And at the same time, your tongue is something that can lead you to Jahannam. This is why Allah says regarding the tongue, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِّمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who can be better than the one who calls towards Allah using that tongue? Who can be better in speech? قَوْلًا means use of the tongue. Who can use the tongue in a better way than he who calls towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But on top of that, he does good deeds himself and he considers himself from amongst the Muslims, from amongst this large group known as Muslims. The minute you say, I'm a Muslim, and you have used your tongue in the correct way, and at the same time you have done good deeds, you can be rest assured that before you die, the angels will come to inform you of a good place in Jannah. That's according to this beautiful verse of Surah Az-Zumar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannatul Firdaus, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says that the angels will descend upon such people prior to their death, just before their death, to give them good news. Don't worry. Don't panic. What's about to happen to you, don't worry. You are going to a beautiful place there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. So my brothers and sisters, the use of the tongue can either make you a person from those who will enter heaven or make you a person from those who will enter hellfire. Take a look at another narration. One of the most powerful narrations that I'm sure a lot of us may have heard because it is the last hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. And it is a hadith that is oft repeated. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, كَلِمَتَانِ خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى اللِّسَانِ ثقيلتان في الميزان، حبيبتان إلى الرحمن، سبحان الله وبحمده، سبحان الله العظيم. The use of the tongue again. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says there are two words that are very light, two little sentences, very light on the tongue. They take nothing from you, nothing at all, very light on the tongue, but very, very heavy on the scales. And at the same time, they are so loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are they? Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Spend a moment to say these words right now. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. They are so heavy in the eyes of Allah. It shows that you can use your tongue to achieve the love of Allah. Once you have the love of Allah, what are you worried about? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. But shaitan keeps attacking, and he keeps telling us to use swear words, falsehood, etc., etc., hurt people's feelings, utter that which is incorrect, invalid, etc., and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. If we do that, what would happen? We would be negating the good that we've done. It's now like a seesaw. When one goes up, the other one goes down. One goes up, the other one goes down. We need to choose which side we want to be heavier. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. So my brothers and sisters, the tongue, absolutely important for us to be able to use it or become conscious of how we use it in such a way that we can earn Jannatul Firdaus through the tongue. Remember when Allah says that you will earn Jannah with this deed, it might seem simple, but in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ala inna sil'ata Allahi ghaliya." He says, behold, the commodity that Allah is selling to you is very expensive. That is Jannah. Allah is giving it to us. It's very expensive. It's not something light. You need to work towards it. It's going to be a tough road there. That's what it's all about. It's a tough road. And as you go through, you need to know how to, you need to know how to wipe out the bad that has happened on your path and convert it into good in such a way that at the end of the race, you find yourself in the front. You know, if you have watched these races or if you know about races, say Formula One or any other race, you find people going around the track. It doesn't mean, even if it comes to athletics, it doesn't mean the person who is at the front at the beginning is the winner. Ultimately, those with experience will tell you, no way, someone near the back who knows what he's doing, he's consistent even in a small way. He's running, but he's consistent in his pace. He's going to win the race. Not a guy who started off with a big bang and suddenly halfway through he's lagging. You know, you have a puncture, you have an accident, you have this, you have that. You know, you went round the race. One split second can drop you behind how far. You know that. The same applies to our path regarding Jannah. The hadith is khairul amali ma dima alayh wa in qal. The best deeds are those that are done regularly, even if they are little, small deeds. Those are the ones where now you're watching the race and you're actually running slowly, slowly. You know that you are consistent, you are trying. Allah says, don't worry, you will win the race. But if you think today I'm a pious man, I'm going to read the whole Quran, and then for the rest of the year there's nothing happening, you are similar to a person who was right in the front. Suddenly you had a flat out, a blowout, and it took you so long to fix it that everybody beat you, and now you're the last person. They had to disqualify you such that people beat you in the lap, such that you were still in the previous lap when they were in the lap that was ahead. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So if you take a look at these type of examples, obviously I'm bringing them just to become closer to our understanding. They apply also in our own deen. Some people, you find them extremely pious, and suddenly the very next day everything else happens and they head in the wrong direction. The hadith says a person can do good deeds for 70 years. Right at the end, they can do such a bad deed that it can result in their loss of entry into Jannah and perhaps their entry into Jahannam. And a person can have done bad deeds for 70 years. Right at the end, they can have done such a powerful deed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them Jannah. It is in the best of our interest to make sure that we don't fall into the first category. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Consistency in our deeds. The fact that we soften our hearts. We finish the month of Ramadan. You see, the month of Ramadan, what happens on the day of Eid? The phone vibrates. Someone was actually joking about it and saying, perhaps that is shaitan with his network now being activated once again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Remember, the parties that we have on the day of Eid are never ever parties to welcome the devil back. But there are parties to be thankful to Allah for giving us the opportunity to worship Him. So on that day, we have an extra ibadah, which is known as the Salah of Eid and the Khutbah of Eid. We are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, these are just a few beautiful words. Obviously, it's a vast topic. if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the opportunity to continue with it, I will probably continue on how to attain Jannah. The reason is all of us would love to enter Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Jannah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.